give good meets from across this great country, including so many young people who represent the dynamism and the talent and the hope of Vietnam. On this visit, my heart has been touched by the kindness for which the Vietnamese people are known. And many people have been lining the streets, smiling and waving. I feel the friendship between our peoples. Last night, I visited the old quarter here in Hanoi and enjoyed some outstanding Vietnamese food. We tried some bún chả. Drank some bia Hanoi. But I have to say, the busy streets of the city, I've never seen so many motorbikes in my life. So I haven't had to try to cross the street so far, but maybe when I come back and visit, you can tell me how. I am not the first American president to come to Vietnam in recent times, but I am the first, like so many of you, who came of age after the war between our countries. When the last U.S. forces left Vietnam, I was just 13 years old. So my first exposure to Vietnam and the Vietnamese people came when I was growing up in Hawaii, with this proud Vietnamese-American community there. At the same time, many people in this country are much younger than me. Like my two daughters, many of you have lived your whole lives knowing only one thing, and that is peace and normalized relations between Vietnam and the United States. So I come here mindful of the past, mindful of our difficult history, but focused on the future, the prosperity, security, and human dignity that we can advance together. I also come here with a deep respect for Vietnam's ancient heritage. For millennia, farmers have tended these lands, history revealed in the Dong Xuân drums. At this bend in the river, Hanoi has endured for more than 1,000 years. The world came to treasure Vietnamese silks and paintings. And the great temple of literature stands as a testament to your pursuit of knowledge. And yet over the centuries, your fate was too often dictated by others. Your beloved land was not always your own. But like bamboo, the unbroken spirit of the Vietnamese people was captured by Lee Chong Kiet. The Southern Emperor rules the Southern land. Our destiny is writ in heaven's book. Today, we also remember the longer history between Vietnamese and Americans that is too often overlooked. More than 200 years ago, when our founding fathers, Thomas Jefferson, saw rice for his farm, he looked to the rice of Vietnam, which he said had the reputation of being whitest to the eye, best flavor to the taste, and most productive. And soon after, American trade ships arrived in your port seeking commerce. During the Second World War, Americans came here to support your struggle against occupation. When American pilots were shot down, the Vietnamese people helped rescue them. And on the day that Vietnam declared its independence, crowds took to the streets of this city, and Ho Chi Minh evoked the American Declaration of Independence. He said, "All people are created equal. The Creator has endowed them with inviolable rights. Among these rights are the right to life, the right to liberty, and the right to pursuit of happiness." In another time, the profession of these shared ideals and our common story of throwing off colonialism might have brought us closer together sooner. But instead, Cold War rivalries and fears of communism pulled us into conflict. Like other conflicts throughout human history, we learned once more a bitter truth, that war, no matter what our intentions may be, bring suffering and tragedy. At your war memorial, not far from here, And with family altars across this country, you remember some 3 million Vietnamese soldiers and civilians on both sides who lost their lives. At our memorial wall in Washington, we can touch the names of 58,315 Americans who gave their lives in the conflict. In both our countries, our veterans and families of the fallen still ache for the friends and loved ones that they lost. Just as we learned in America that even if we disagree about a war, we must always honor those who serve and welcome them home with the respect they deserve, we can join together today, Vietnamese and Americans, and acknowledge the pain and the sacrifices on both sides. More recently, over the past 2 decades, Vietnam has achieved enormous progress. And today, the world can see the strides that you have made. With economic reforms and trade agreements, including with the United States, you have entered the global economy, selling your goods around the world. More foreign investment is coming in. And with one of the fastest growing economies in Asia, Vietnam has moved up to become a middle-income nation. We see Vietnam's progress in the skyscrapers and high-rises, Hanoi, Ho Chi Minh City, new shopping malls and urban centers. We see it in the satellites Vietnam puts into space, and the new generation that is online, launching startups and running new ventures. We see it in the tens of millions of Vietnamese connected on Facebook and Instagram. And you're not just posting selfies, although I hear you do that a lot. And so far, there have been a number of people who've already asked me for selfies. You're also raising your voices for causes that you care about, like saving the old trees in Hanoi. So all this dynamism has delivered real progress in people's lives. Here in Vietnam, you've dramatically reduced extreme poverty, you've boosted family incomes, and lifted millions into a fast-growing middle class. Hunger, disease, child and maternal mortality are all down. The number of people with clean drinking water and electricity, the number of boys and girls in school, and your literacy rate, these are all up. This is extraordinary progress. This is what you have been able to achieve in a very short time. And as Vietnam has transformed, so has the relationship between our two nations. We learned a lesson taught by the venerable Thich Nhat Hanh, who said, in true dialogue, both sides are willing to change. In this way, the very war that had divided us became a source for healing. It allowed us to account for the missing and finally bring them home. It allowed us to help remove landmines and unexploded bombs, because no child should ever lose a leg just playing outside. Even as we continue to assist Vietnamese with disabilities, including children, we are also continuing to help remove Agent Orange, dioxin, so that Vietnam can reclaim more of your land. We're proud of our work together in Da Nang, and we look forward to supporting your efforts in Bien Hoa. Let's also not forget that the reconciliation between our countries was led by our veterans who once faced each other in battle. Think of Senator John McCain, who was held for years here as a prisoner of war, meeting General Zapp, who said our countries should not be enemies but friends. Think of all the veterans, Vietnamese and American, who've helped us heal and build new ties. Few have done more in this regard over the years than a former Navy lieutenant and now Secretary of State for the United States, John Kerry, who is here today. On behalf of all of us, John, we thank you for your service. Because our veterans showed us the way, because warriors had the courage to pursue peace, our peoples are now closer than ever before. Our trade has surged, our students and scholars learn together, We welcome more Vietnamese students to America than from any other country in Southeast Asia. And every year, you welcome more and more American tourists, including young Americans with their backpacks, to Hanoi's 36 streets, and the shops of Hoi An and the imperial city of Hue. As Vietnamese and Americans, we can all relate to those words written by Van Gogh. From now, we know each other's homeland. From now, we learn to feel for each other. As president, I built on this progress. With our new comprehensive partnership, our governments are working more closely together than ever before. And with this visit, we've put our relationship on a firmer footing for decades to come. In a sense, the long story between our two nations that began with Thomas Jefferson more than two centuries ago has now come full circle. It's taken many years and required great effort. But now we can say something that was once unimaginable. Today, Vietnam and the United States are partners. And I believe our experience holds lessons for the world. At a time when many conflicts seem intractable, seem as if they will never end, we have shown that hearts can change and that a different future is possible when we refuse to be prisoners of the past. We've shown how peace can be better than war. We've shown that progress of human dignity is best advanced by cooperation and not conflict. That's what Vietnam and America can show the world. Now, America's new partnership with Vietnam is rooted in some basic truths. Vietnam is an independent, sovereign nation, and no other nation can impose its will on you or decide your destiny. The United States has an interest here. We have an interest in Vietnam's success. But our comprehensive partnership is still in its early stages. And with the time I have left, I want to share with you the vision that I believe can guide us in the decades ahead. First, let's work together to create real opportunity and prosperity for all of our people. We know the ingredients for economic success in the 21st century. In our global economy, investment and trade flows to wherever there is rule of law, because no one wants to pay a bribe to start a business. Nobody wants to sell their goods or go to school if they don't know how they're going to be treated. In knowledge-based economies, jobs go to where people have the freedom to think for themselves and exchange ideas and to innovate. And real economic partnerships are not just about one country extracting resources from another. They're about investing in our greatest resource, which is our people and their skills and their talents, whether you live in a big city or a rural village. And that's the kind of partnership that America offers. As I announced yesterday, the Peace Corps will come to Vietnam for the first time with a focus on teaching English. And a generation after the young Americans came there to fight, a new generation of Americans are going to come here to teach and build and deepen the friendships between us. Some of America's leading technology companies and academic institutions are joining Vietnamese universities to strengthen training in science, technology, engineering, mathematics, and medicine. Because even as we keep welcoming more Vietnamese students to America, we also believe that young people deserve a world-class education right here in Vietnam. It's one of the reasons why we're very excited that this fall, the new Fulbright University of Vietnam will open in Ho Chi Minh City, this nation's first independent, nonprofit university, where there will be full academic freedom and scholarships for those in need. Students, scholars, researchers will focus on public policy and management and business, on engineering and computer science, and liberal arts. Everything from the poetry of Nguyễn Du to the philosophy of Bancho Ching to the mathematics of